Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for the positives and negatives of screen time during a pandemic. My name is Victoria Brurek, and I'm the digital content producer here at Pandemic Parenting. We're so excited to have you all join us tonight. This webinar is part of our bi-weekly Pandemic Parenting Exchange series, and to find recordings of all our previous webinars, you can visit our website. I'll drop a link to that in the chat in just a moment. To stay up to date on the latest webinars, you can follow us on social media and subscribe to our email list. If you are subscribed to our email list, you'll be the first to know when the recordings and related resources are available. With that, I want to introduce Pandemic Parenting's co-founders. Dr. Amanda Zelahusky is a clinical and forensic psychologist and an associate professor of psychology at Valparaiso University. Dr. Lindsay Malloy is a developmental and forensic psychologist and an associate professor at Ontario Tech University. You can read more about them and their backgrounds on our website. With that, I'll turn it over to Lindsay.
Okay, thank you, Victoria, and thank you everyone for being here tonight. We're really excited to have this very important conversation tonight. We want to thank everyone for being here tonight, but also for anyone who made a contribution to Pandemic Parenting for Giving Tuesday. We really appreciate that. If you are, you know, dying to offload any cash before the end of the year, we do have an opportunity for you to make tax-exempt donations. As Amanda and I always say, we are donating all of our time to Pandemic Parenting, but we have a great small staff that helps us provide all of these resources. So we would welcome those. We want to say thank you to Division 53 of the American Psychological Association for the small grant that we received from them to do this work, and our content partner, Zulily. So why we wanted to have this conversation, I'm not even going to spend much time there tonight because that should be pretty obvious. Screen time was one of the hottest topics before the pandemic, and it certainly has only been amplified in the last however many months we are into this now. It's also one of those topics where there's a lot of judgment regarding people's parenting practices, and I think some real misunderstandings about what the research evidence, you know, really shows us when it comes to screen time. So we have three amazing experts who are going to join us tonight. But first, I want to introduce our moderator for tonight's session, Natalie Hong. So Natalie is a fifth-year doctoral candidate in the Clinical Science in Child and Adolescent Psychology PhD program at Florida International University in Miami. Her program of research focuses on optimizing children's mental health care through innovative treatment redesign. She is particularly interested in developing an evidence base for informed clinical decision-making for children who exhibit slower or fewer improvements through the course of treatment or throughout the course of treatment. And one of our goals here at Pandemic Parenting has always been to highlight emerging scholars in the field. So we're really excited to have Natalie joining us tonight and moderating this session on screen time. So I'll turn it over to you, Natalie.
Thank you so much for the introduction and for the opportunity to join tonight's webinar. I'm really looking forward to learning more about this topic myself. So tonight we will start off with a discussion amongst our guest experts surrounding the pros and cons of screen time, and then wrap up with a Q&A that's based on audience members' feedback. To begin, I'm excited to introduce my mentor, Dr. John Comer, who is a professor of psychology and psychiatry at Florida International University. His research focuses on pediatric anxiety, traumatic stress, and disruptive behavior disorders. And he has conducted extensive research studying the well-being of families and psychological adjustment of youth in the context of disasters, terrorism, and other community traumas, including the effects of children's exposure to media coverage of these events. With us tonight, we also have Dr. Sheri Madigan, who is an associate professor and Canada research chair in determinants of child development at the University of Calgary and the Alberta Children's Hospital Research Institute. Her research is primarily focused on understanding how early experiences, including exposure to digital technology, can help and/or hinder children's learning and behavior. Her work has been widely covered in the media, including the New York Times, Time, BBC, CNN, Good Morning America, and in the documentary Kids vs. Screens. And we also have Dr. Brae Ann McArthur with us, who is a postdoctoral research fellow at the University of Calgary. Her program of research focuses on understanding individual and family level risk and resiliency factors that influence child development. And her current work focuses on understanding the impact of screen time on child development, specifically as it relates to behavior problems and psychopathology.
Before we get started, I wanted to just take a moment to honor our colleague and friend, Dr. Bethany Reeves Sutherland, who passed away just a few weeks ago after a long and difficult journey with breast cancer. So I hope you'll forgive me if I just read this section. So I want to get through it all. Before I started my current position in Ontario, I was at Florida International University for 7 years. And Bethany started as an assistant professor the year after I did. And I know that the entire FAU community is really feeling her enormous loss right now. And given that John, who was a close friend of Bethany's, and Natalie are joining us tonight from FAU, it felt right to honor Bethany and her many contributions to the field of child development. So Bethany ran the Brain and Behavioral Development Lab at FAU, and her research concerned the socio-emotional development of infants and children. And at the age of 4 months, my son participated in his very first research study in her lab. And it was really fun to be on the parent side of things for once and to see Bethany work her magic testing infants with EEG. In 2017, Bethany received the Early Career Impact Award from the Federation of Associations in Behavioral and Brain Science for her major contributions to advancing the sciences of mind, brain, and behavior. And that same year, she was awarded the FIU Provost Award for Outstanding Mentorship for Graduate Students. Student mentorship and support was extremely important to Bethany, and the FIU Psychology Graduate Student Hardship Fund, which she really championed, has been renamed in her honor. So Pandemic Parenting is making a contribution to this fund. And if anyone else would like to, we wanted to provide a link in the chat, and Victoria has provided the QR codes as well. And there's also an opportunity to support Bethany's husband, also an FIU colleague, and their two young sons. And so that is the other link that you see there. It's great to be able to honor her and her many contributions tonight as we are here talking about children's development as it relates to behavior and brain development tonight. So I'm going to pass it back to Natalie now for her to start on our many, many, many questions for our panelists on screen time.
And thank you so much for taking the time to honor Bethany and for giving all of us the opportunity to reflect on her wonderful contributions to the field and to our community. In turning to our panel discussion that surrounding screen time this evening, I'm wondering if each of our panelists can start off just by sharing briefly a bit about the research that you do that's related to screen time and kids and what you may have noticed or found during the COVID-19 pandemic in particular. And Sheri, maybe you can begin.
Sure. So my primary area of research is really looking at the kids 0 to 5. And so I've been doing, we're really fortunate to be working with a group here called the All Our Families team that's been following a group of families from pregnancy. And now that kids are actually between the ages of 9 and 11, and we've done about 9 different surveys with the mom. And just recently during COVID, we've actually recruited the youth to participate in a survey for the first time. But we've done the majority of our data analysis really looking at screen time early in child development, and Brae can talk a little bit more about some of the work that she's done as well. But I've been really interested in how, basically how much screen time kids are getting, but what they're missing, what screen time is replacing. So we've been looking at, when children are getting lots of screen time, are they meeting their developmental milestones? Are they walking, talking, holding a crayon, doing all the things we want them to do in terms of preparation for kindergarten at a pace that we'd hope them to be? So that's been sort of really the bulk of a lot of the work that we've been doing. And then more recently, really trying to see what screen time means for all these offline activities that kids might be doing. So again, if kids are getting a lot of screen time, does that mean they're missing out on physical activity, on reading, on all these other things that we want them to do, because we know that can really kind of enrich their early life experiences?
Thanks so much for sharing that. And I know you were referring to some of the work that Brae has been working on with you too. So Brae, if you don't mind sharing a little too.
Yeah, building off of some of what Sheri said, I think right now we're focusing a lot on that 9 to 11 age range that we have data for, and we're taking, I guess we're using this kind of unique opportunity to see what happens when kids get increased screen time, as we're gonna talk about during our conversation today. I'm primarily more interested in looking at mental health outcomes and the impact that screen time can have on that for tweens and teens.
So hi, I'm John Comer. As Natalie mentioned, I'm a clinical psychologist. I focus on early child anxiety, disruptive behavior problems, irritability. I've also studied kids during normal times, then also during very abnormal times. I did a lot of work after the 9/11 attacks with kids in New York, after the Boston Marathon bombing in Boston, and more recently Hurricane Irma. And then Dr. Malloy and I are working on a large-scale study looking over time at families. We have almost 2,000 families. We're looking across multiple time points and studying how kids are doing and how they're faring. A sort of theme throughout a lot of my disasters work and my work with kids in public health crises is that it's not always the most directly affected kids. It's much more about the subjective exposure. So sometimes, you know, for example, after 9/11, kids that were going to school across the street from the World Trade Center often were faring pretty well. And then there were kids in the outer boroughs that were having much more extreme mental health outcomes that were concerning. So I think media effects we've looked at as a real part of that, that it's sometimes what they're being, what information, what news they're being exposed to. And also just another sort of overall theme is that there's such a wide range of outcomes the majority of kids do very well during times of crisis, and a smaller proportion of kids are the ones that we need to be worried about more.
Yeah, thank you each for sharing a little bit to give us context in thinking about this conversation. And I'm wondering too about screen time and quantity. So the question that a lot of parents have or want to sort of hear more about in general, but especially right now during the pandemic, is related to how much is too much time. So Sheri or Brae, if you can start again, sort of thinking about the amount of exposure.
Yeah, so we actually conducted a study that we called kind of the tipping point, looking at how much is too much. We looked at three-year-olds. So this is focusing more on the younger age range, but we did find that children who were getting more than the one recommended 1 hour limit were actually experiencing more declines in developmental milestones, so kind of walking, talking on time. They also had more maternal reported behavioral difficulties, and they had poor language acquisition. So we are seeing that there is some relationship with kind of the recommendations for those smaller children. I don't know, Sheri, if you have anything you want to add.
No, I think there's sort of a digital tipping point where it gets into being too much. You know, if people are really interested, they can go and visit the American Academy of Pediatrics, or if you're in Canada, you can go to the Canadian Pediatric Society, and they have really good guidelines around screen use. And in children under the age of two, it's actually recommended that they don't get much more than, you know, FaceTiming with family. And in kids 2 to 5, it's 1 hour a day. And then above the age of five, there used to be a 2 hour limit suggestion, but that's actually been pulled back a little bit more recently. And the encouragement is actually that you help children, you monitor their screen use, you make it meaningful for them, and that you really model healthy device habits. And so it's actually, you know, trying to push parents to actually think more about the quality of screen use versus the quantity per se. And that's something that we've been doing a lot in our work, is really trying to look at this difference between the quality of use versus the quantity. And at every opportunity, if you can enhance quality in some way, you know, I think that that's really important. And I do think there's a digital tipping point where it's too much, but I do think, like John was saying, it's actually really a small percentage of families that are having excessive screen use, you know, maybe 6-7 hours a day, and really small kids, you know, these are in 2 to 5 year olds, but the large majority of families are, you know, using a moderate, small to moderate amount of screen use. So I think that's encouraging.
And I'll just add, I agree with everything that's been said. You know, this is a time for flexibility and sort of forgiveness with ourselves. You mentioned 6 hours. So I have one of my children is 7, one of my children is 9. They're both on screen in school 6 hours a day. So that's before, you know, we even think about entertainment, socialization, you know, extracurricular stuff they're doing online. So, you know, the idea of, you know, 6 hours, that's just what the school's requiring. That's sort of the starting point. So, you know, I very much agree with, you know, it's often I think of when we're balancing things out, you know, parental depression is much more harmful to kids than screen time, social isolation, lack of stimulation. And some families are going to find themselves in positions. We're in the middle of course, a global crisis, and we're going to all have to do the calculus. If a parent needs some of that break and screen time is, you know, in a pinch, getting them, you know, that needed, you know, 10 minutes, 30 minutes, 45 minutes to center themselves, that might actually be more important to the child in the long run. So I think it's a complicated calculus, and I totally agree with what Sheri just said about quality versus quantity. You know, we want to think about, is it interactive versus passive? Is it, you know, who are they interacting with? Is it, you know, is it family time? Are they, you know, is it something that they're interacting with? What are they doing on technology? And are they multitasking, which gets extra complicated and might be more problematic than sort of, so to speak, single tasking. So it is a little more complicated than I think the sort of mainstream media wants that sort of, you know, what's the number, and then I'll do exactly that many minutes. So,
well, how does that get balanced with, you know, schools, which we're seeing a lot of people comment in the chat, right? Schools are requiring, as you said, you know, a certain number of hours, like John, you said, you know, for your kids, 6 hours a day already, the school, because of Zoom synchronous meetings and such. So how do we sort of marry that to really trying to think about things like quality versus quantity and control the screen time when in fact that's their education delivery now?
Well, I can answer this really quickly, but for a lot of, you know, when we're asking about screen time, we're often asking what are kids getting, you know, screen time duration in terms of their fun, you know, streaming videos, gaming. It's really typically the hours outside of that kids are getting on in an educational way or through, you know, online schooling. So when we're talking about quality of screen use, it's really, or just screen use, it's usually, we usually preface it in a question as how much are you screen use are you getting for fun? So when that's up to 6 or 7 hours a day, that's when we get a bit more concerned. And as clinicians, we wanna often talk to families about, okay, what's going on? You know, what are they doing on screens? But, you know, a large part of children are on screens for school, and we typically don't count that into our metrics, just to give parents an understanding of like where those numbers are coming from.
And there's like, even if it's for fun, there's, you know, there's like Just Dance, you know, where kids are getting their heart rate up, but, you know, there's still options too, you know, even if, you know, we're stuck inside and it's cold and, you know, so there's even within bad options, there's still better options.
I think it was really interesting and helpful to hear about that sort of dynamic between quality and quantity. And Sheri, you mentioning, you know, make that time meaningful. And I'm wondering if you all can speak a little bit to what sort of recommended ways you can sort of tailor your screen time to make it meaningful. Just Dance sounds like an example of that. But are there other sort of platforms, apps, or things in particular that you recommend families sort of turn to if it is going to be screen time for fun?
I'm going to guess it's not watching a woman unbox toys on YouTube Kids, but if you could say that, I would be, you know, very grateful.
Well, how about if I say, if you're sitting down and watching your child unbox something on YouTube and you're enjoying it together, then, you know, then that can be quality based because you're enjoying something together. There's engagement on that. So, you know, one of the big sort of, so I'll tell you about a study that we have that where we show that when it's just long durations of solitary sedentary activity in front of a screen. We're seeing that it's not linked to children's. It's actually, it's negatively associated with children's language. So high just amounts of solitary screening, poor language development. But when we looked at the quality of the screen viewing, so was the child sitting with the caregiver and watching it together? Well, it was actually linked to positive language development. Was the programming educational? It was linked to positive language development. So those are those nuances that I think we're all trying to get at a little bit, that we can actually choose some higher quality programming, or we can sit and enjoy screens with one another. And that actually can be a really positive and developmentally appropriate and enhancing experience for kids. It's when kids are sitting in front of screens for hours at a time, and as John said, they're not moving, you know, there's not some engagement, they're not connecting with someone. So I think when we're talking about quality, that's really what we're talking about, is making it meaningful and high quality based. And if that means watching a YouTube video where kids are unboxing gifts, I mean, enjoy it together. I think that's one of my big sort of take home points, is enjoy it together and make it as meaningful as possible for them by, like, if you have a three-year-old and you're watching, and they're watching Elmo, just pop in every once in a while and say, yep, that's Elmo, he's red, and then pop back into the, you know, kitchen to finish your meal or whatever, but just try to make it meaningful them, and that can be really helpful.
And if parents are wondering where to find some of these, like what is educational and what's not, we're still working on trying to sort some of that out, but Common Sense Media is a great website that offers recommendations by age range. And they actually have some recommendations about box opening YouTube streaming things. So they have viewed the different options, and they will tell you which ones they think are best for your children to be viewing. So you can check that out.
Excellent. Thank you.
And then, you know, you could play with that and find more creative ways to, you know, you could have your child film their own unboxing video where you put your phone there and, you know, you put some of their old toys in a box and you just show their hands. I mean, those of us with kids certainly know about unboxing videos and how mesmerizing they can be. But, you know, if a child is narrating the unboxing, you know, all of a sudden it's creative, it's imaginative. It's you know, it's less passive. And so I tend to find that within most habits, there's sort of a better option, you know, a way to sort of shake it up a little bit and make it more engaging and creative.
And I appreciate those suggestions about, or how you're all clarifying what interacting is, right? Like sometimes I hear that and I assume that means I really have to sit down and watch the half hour unboxing video with my kid, or for my kids, it's watching them watch other kids on YouTube play video games, which I just don't understand. But so the way you're sort of explaining, it doesn't mean that you have to sit and engross in the whole thing. It can be popping by and, you know, sort of, oh, that's that guy you like again. Is he winning this time? You know, like just a sort of these quick interactions or moments of connection, it sounds like, is good quality, not necessarily that you have to sit there with them for the whole hour or half hour engrossed as they are in the show.
Yeah, and I think there's a really good example of that from like early research from really young kids, is that there's this transfer deficit. So when kids are watching something on a screen, and say they watch someone putting blocks on top of each other, and you think, oh, they're learned, if I give them blocks, they'll actually know to do that. Well, turns out they don't. There's a transfer deficit, especially in kids under three, from what they view on the screen to what they can do in real life. And that's because they're going from two-dimensional to three-dimensional real life. And so if we can then as caregivers say, hey, they just built some blocks, I'll show you how they built those blocks, and you do it live, that's how they learn. So we have to sort of be the bridge for them for some of the learning, especially, I mean, I'm an early childhood researcher, so I'm talking about those little ones in particular, but we bridge that learning from them, and then we can enhance, you know, understanding for them. But we do have to be the bridge. So it takes popping in sometimes, or taking that moment to talk through what they might be seeing or understanding from the screen.
As you mentioned, as an early childhood researcher, some of the conversation so far has focused on these early ages. And I'm wondering if your recommendations or what you found have differed across sort of the developmental cycle, sort of stages, and thinking about some of those older school age kids, middle schoolers. I see some people in the chat talking about teenagers as well. Do the recommendations differ as kids get older? how would you all speak to that?
One thing that Amanda actually alluded to with the popping in and out, that can be a form of co-viewing or taking part in it with your child, but it can also increase your awareness of what they're doing. And a lot of our most recent research with tweens has really shown that parental awareness of children's media use, so just generally what they're doing, what they're engaging in, how they're engaging in it, is quite predictive of child outcomes as well. So I think for that older age group, you know, they do want more autonomy. They don't want you sitting beside them on the couch watching the show with them or watching them play their game. So just being kind of on top of what they're doing can have a big impact as well.
Yeah, and I think when you're talking about older kids, you know, you're still a sort of a, you know, with younger kids, you're sort of a benevolent dictator, but with older kids, it's a little more democratic. And you want to sort of create family rules together, right? And, you know, so you want, you know, it's a little variant of, do you want to go to bed now or in 3 minutes? And you really are constraining the options. But you want to have kids help co-create, you know, they take some ownership in it. They understand overall they can't be on these things all the time. What are, you know, and then you're also navigating important family processes of compromise and communication. So that's really important too. And then, you know, another thing is how important it is not just to have media rules for children, but to have family media rules. If you expect your child to not be texting during dinner, then you can't be checking your work emails as they pop in during dinner. If you're expecting your child to have, no media in the last 2 hours before bedtime, that's a really good rule. But, kids learn just as much by modeling as, you know, being reinforced directly. So especially when it's with their parents, and, you know, there's nothing more powerful than, you know, seeing our parents' behavior. So so it's also just as important to look at our own media habits. I think a lot of parents I work with, just because they're not enjoying it doesn't mean they're not consumed by their media. So just because it's an annoying work email, just because it's not some game doesn't mean that in some way it's a different beast when it, you know, it's going to be more complicated for kids to understand too. So
That is so hard during this pandemic, right? Because we're most of us working from home, we are glued to our screens for our work too. So even when your kids are home with you all day, they're seeing you glued to your screen too. And so I just think that it was easier, I guess, at least for me, when my work was not physically in my home, I could have that separation, but we're glued to these devices too. So, and I think even just things like, I do a lot of reading on devices, they don't see me read actual books anymore. And so how can we intentionally do those things to get us off our screens and model that for our kids too? But it has been so hard the last 9 months.
Oh, I agree. It's very hard, and I have kids at home and it's difficult. And one of the things that we've tried doing is actually like really disconnecting at a point. So we all, like, you can have a device basket, pop those devices in there if you can. And, you know, we often say try to disconnect when everyone can at the end of the day, maybe around a family meal, so that you can reconnect as a family. And if we can find that reconnection point in, you know, maybe around a meal or whatever, maybe you all head outside or whatever it is. And then I think if you get back on screens later, because as a parent, you're really tired and you need to utilize them again, that's okay. But you've made that, like, I think, transition point where everyone comes together again. And for us, that's been really critical sort of to our survival in a pandemic with 4 kids at home and, you know, 2 working parents. So I think, like, creating that time has been really important. And there's a great app. You can go to healthychildren.org and do a family media plan. And actually, it's an interactive plan where you can put in your children's ages and you can make choices as to how as a family you're going to use screens, when you're going to use them, where you're going to use them. And this app will actually help you create that plan. And I think it's never too late to make one. And then what we know about kids is that if you get them involved in the plan making, they're actually much more likely to buy in. So, you know, you can get them involved in, like, how much do you think is a healthy amount of screen time at night? And then, you know, if they say, well, 1 hour, you say, that sounds like a good plan. And then you make that part of your plan and the kids are going to buy in, potentially buy in, because, you know, you've made that choice together. So that's one suggestion I would have for parents who are really, you know, understandably juggling a lot right now.
I love that. I think it's really helpful. Go ahead.
And just as much about media habits, we're teaching our kids about structure, consistency, and flexibility during times of stress. And this is a very unique situation we're in, but stress is not unique, and they're going to be harder years than others. And we're teaching kids about maintaining as much structure and routine as possible, and also having thoughtful flexibility that makes life work. And those are two very important lessons about coping, opportunities to really teach kids about emotion regulation and coping during stress.
Absolutely. Yeah, I was wondering too about sort of the quality of research evidence that's out there on screen time. I think there are a lot of headlines that are sort of causing concern about there being too much screen time and what that screen time may lead to or what that could cause, but also sort of looking to provide some recommendations to caregivers regarding being critical consumers of those media sort of articles or stories out there. Do you guys have any advice to those who may be reading them about how to sort of better understand what the research says about this relationship?
In one of my Facebook, online mom group type of situations, I remember a headline that was like, you know, screen time causes brain damage in kids. And then, you know, everyone in the group kind of obviously understandably becoming quite upset about this headline. And I think, acknowledging too, as that discussion really highlighted, like all of the layers of privilege involved in, well, who can afford other activities for their kids that, you know, don't involve screens, or, you know, just the really tough decisions that parents are having to make. So yeah, I would love to be able to help parents with those kinds of headlines, like screen time causes brain damage in children.
So I can assure you that every time I speak to a reporter, I say, and I'm sure John and Brae say the same thing, these are not causal associations. So it's something that we really emphasize as researchers, but oftentimes doesn't get transmitted into the news headlines. So even though we've done a lot of research that has ended up in the news, none of it has been causal in any way, but then we see, you know, these causal headlines. And so I think that you have to take those headlines knowing that the research and screen literature can't be causal, because we can't artificially induce some children to get a ton of screen time, because we'd never get that through our ethics boards. So we can't do that to them. So In that way, it's very hard to get causal research because you can't do experimental research in that way. So I just want to assure any parent out there that if you read that kind of headline, to really, usually they include a link to the study, and you can learn more about the study that way just by reading it. And most of the time we're surveying families, and in no way is it causal. That's my reassurance to them. Yeah.
Yeah, and I was going to say to look for the source. I think the first thing, I'm a mom too, and I'm not the only one out there doing research, so I love reading what other people are up to. But the first thing I do is look at, okay, where did this article come from? Where is it being published? Do they talk about a qualified professional doing the research? And then also checking some of those sites that I know have evidence-based information, like Media Smarts in Canada and Common Sense Media and Children and Screens in the US. So there's lots of options out there where you can kind of get information that's been at least reviewed before pushed out to everybody on Facebook. So we're in the era of fake news. You never know what you're getting.
Mm. Yeah, and just so is that if you want a causal association, you have to put, you have to kind of take 100 kids and artificially give them something like lots and lots of screen time, and then have 100 kids that don't get anything, and then you compare them. So that's the only study where you'd actually be able to draw causal associations. And as far as I know, those do not exist in the screen time literature. I'm sure Brae would know too if there's
anything. Given that, you know, more than half of the four-year-olds have tablets now, where it's right. Hard to have kids who haven't had exposure, so.
I remember there's a study I talk about in my child development class where they randomly assigned half of the kids to have a TV on in the background during, you know, a learning session, and half of them not to. And so they found that having the TV on in the background impaired their learning of this information, right? So in that, we can, you know, put that very specific situation, right? But like Sheri is saying, in terms of randomly assigning kids or families to get certain amounts of screen time, it's just not going to happen. And but I know that the media likes to have those sexy headlines, you know, that they talk to us and then they, you know, you get the story and you're like, that is not what I said. That is not what we found.
I think also sometimes the media draws on maybe the negative outcomes a little bit more. We, like Sheri mentioned, the publicity around our review of screen studies relating to language development probably spoke more about how it was hurting children's language development instead of talking about how co-viewing and quality can actually improve some language skills. So we don't often hear about the little positive nuggets that come out of our research as much as mm-hmm. those negative.
And I think that thinking about, you know, some of our conversation too about limiting screen time and also the quality of the interaction surrounding screen time, I wanted to ask a little bit about what research has shown in terms of potential benefits of using screens, tablets, apps, other sorts of media devices in that way.
You know, one thing that's very clear is screens are the world that we're preparing kids for, whether we like it or not. It's going to be very hard for kids to succeed or certainly thrive in the world they're developing into if they are not comfortable with screens, if they're not computer literate. Obviously, taken to an extreme, it's like anything, very problematic. But and I think most kids right now in the context of the pandemic have, if not already, have been sort of immersed in a technology-based world. But especially during the pandemic, for many kids, you know, technology screens, media are the lifelines to friends, to family, you know, grandparents. You know, a lot of grandparents and children haven't been seeing each other. Fitness even. Extracurricular activities where, you know, kids are in dance classes where they're all lined up. You know, screens, you know, I think that earlier on in the research, it was hard to envision some of the positive aspects of how well screens can connect us and facilitate us to do the very things we want to be doing more of and connect us and make the world smaller and sort of put us more in that global village. So I think as technology has gotten so much better, as internet has gotten so much faster, as computing technology has gotten so much smaller, and, you know, we all have internet in our pocket, and now we have wearables, and, you know, we're headed in some really interesting directions in terms of how integrated technology is into our lives. You know, we're doing a disservice if we're sort of not preparing kids for that reality of the world in which we live.
That's why, you know, everything John's saying, I think that's why we have to get kids to think more meaningfully about screen use. And I'm sure a lot of parents have watched The Social Dilemma and heard about, you know, persuasive design on technology. And because this is our future, where, you know, these screens and the ease and accessibility of it, I think one of the roles we play, especially with older kids, is actually talking to them about media and what it means to be engaged with media and the different, the persuasive design of media. And I can give an example where, you know, my child yesterday said to me, you know, can I log on to that app? Because it's been 24 hours and I get a present every 24 hours, you know? So I was like, oh, okay. So I could have just said, no, like, you can't have an iPad right now. But I thought, okay, this is an opportunity to talk to him about what that's all about. So, you know, the reason they give you this prize every 24 hours is that so you actually log on, open the app. And what happens when you open the app? Well, he's like, well, I want to play the app. And I said, well, exactly. So these are strategies that they use to kind of get you hooked and engaged. And so, you know, I think our role, knowing that they are growing up in this very technological world, is to actually make it meaningful for them and to really build understanding about the sort of sub features of persuasive design that's inherent in all these technologies.
Yeah, okay. One other benefit, just I know a lot of us are clinicians also, that I've seen for kids and especially teenagers is access to mental health care, right? Is using the technology to give them access to therapists through telepsychology, telehealth, that they wouldn't have otherwise had. And I know there's a lot of pros and cons to that, but I see quite a few people asking in the chat also just about increases in things like depression and anxiety in teens. And with a lot of the families we've been talking with, the ability to access counseling and therapy through technology has been just a benefit or a lifesaver in some of these cases. So there are lots of benefits, I think, that are important for us to think about and not get just lost in all of the negatives.
Totally. And, you know, for kids who need adaptive technology, this has been so critical for them. For kids who might have learning disabilities and they learn better by, you know, their spelling tests, they do a lot better if they're writing their words on a computer than if they're writing them down, for example. I mean, this is really important. And there are a lot of really positive benefits to technology. And I think if there's one takeaway point for me, it's just that we need to use it in moderation, just like we would junk food and a lot of other delights that we might experience in life. You know, it's all about moderation and as much as possible, like really prioritizing points of connection over technology versus just long durations of solitary use.
A lot of John's research is actually looking at delivery of mental health services over via telehealth and such. Right. So,
yeah. And Natalie as well, actually. Our group does lots of research before there was the pandemic, looking at remote formats for real time, what we call synchronous therapy. So we do a lot of work, what's called parent child interaction therapy, PCIT, where traditionally the family comes in and mom or dad has an earpiece and the therapist is behind a one-way mirror. So the therapist was already separated from the family and they provide live coaching directly in the parent's ear. So what we did is we developed a format where parents are at home, they have a Bluetooth earpiece, web cameras, the therapist is providing remotely live treatment directly in the home. And in our randomized trial, we compared, we randomly assigned, like picking assigned treatment out of a hat. Half the families got the internet format, half the families got the traditional clinic format. And we actually found that what are called masked evaluators, independent evaluators who didn't know what treatment conditions the kids were in, there was a higher rate of what was classified excellent response in the internet condition. So it's really an exciting time for, there's been lots of research. And our thinking there is, in addition to expanding the reach of treatment, there's something about treating kids in their own setting, right? We could sort of have these contrived scenarios in our offices and let's pretend this is the dinner table. What would you do? But if you're at the dinner table, it's a whole other world and it's more realistic and there's more generalizability and maintenance of gains. So the things that have held back telehealth for so long have not been its effectiveness. The effectiveness research is really strong. It's been, will healthcare companies pay for that? And also therapist liability, where therapists didn't go to school for IT. And if, there was some sort of breach, hacking, are they gonna be in professional ruin or personal ruin? So one thing that the federal government did at the beginning of the pandemic in North America was they very quickly removed those obstacles. And so they mandated that payers cover telehealth. And they also said that if telehealth was being done in good faith as an effort to mitigate the spread of COVID-19, then there will be no pursuing any HIPAA violations against the providers. So providers were no longer scared they were gonna get sued and they were able to get reimbursed for their services. And it's a temporary rule right now, but I don't see the genie going back in the bottle. I think people are finding that the benefits are so strong.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And we're having a lot of questions from audience members. So John, I'm gonna sort of keep you on the spot because we have a few of our members asking questions about your work on children's exposure to media coverage on other disasters like the Boston Marathon bombing and how it relates to their adjustment. And specifically wondering how you see this playing out when it comes to the COVID-19 pandemic and such an extended amount of time in terms of this sort of disaster potential repercussions.
Sure. So this is very different from any other disaster that I've studied. I've tended to study historically more acute events that have a you know, a clear ending very quickly, and people were either devastated or not. This has been such a prolonged ripple of hardship, you know, that has led to further hardships and economic hardships, and you know, it just goes on and on how this is impacting everyone. So what I do find is that people tend to come, families tend to come out of disasters and public health crises as exaggerated versions of what they came into them as. It's not necessarily always what they were exposed to in the event. So 9/11, it wasn't as much how much direct exposure they had to the towers falling, but those who had prior trauma, those from ethnic or racial minority backgrounds or low income backgrounds, those who were at higher risk before, those families with higher conflict before, came out of it with much higher conflict. And same with the Boston Marathon bombing. It mattered less where you were than who you were before it happened. And so I think right now we're seeing that, you know, Lindsay and I are doing research and you know, we haven't run the formal data analyses yet because we're still collecting our data. But, you know, in talking with families, in work, I run a child anxiety clinic, you know, in hearing from families, you know, I think the families that had good structure, predictability, warmth, follow through, they're thriving. And the families that had more trouble with childcare, the families that had more conflict, the kids who were more irritable, they're the families that we're seeing becoming more exaggerated versions of themselves. So I think, you know, a lot of parents are like, am I doing this wrong? Am I doing that wrong? And a lot of times it's really a lot of families, when they're really getting down to what they're struggling with, it's some of the same dynamics and patterns and ruts that they've been stuck in, and just sort of an exaggerated version of sort of working for them before, but now under this stress, it's sort of bursting over.
We're actually seeing that in our work as well, that job loss or loss of income or difficulty securing childcare are some of the predictors that related to increased screen use for our youth sample. And that families that had kind of good family connection before, connection with siblings, good contact with external family members, using, you know, screen time to connect with grandparents or other supports, were the ones that were doing better.
Another question that we're getting is related to how to set limits around screen time. So we've talked a little bit about the importance of trying to have those limits, but what approaches work best in setting limits? A punitive approach, a timer, threats? What do you all think?
I can say from experience that my suggestions do not always work, but because it's very difficult to get my children off screen sometimes, but I'll give some suggestions and people can try it out. And what we know from our research is that some suggestions are gonna work for some kids and not others. And it really kind of depends on your child's typical kind of engagement with screens, but also just their temperament and predisposition. So here are some strategies. Try them out. You can let us know how they go. But you can set a timer, like I think someone mentioned in the chat, which is great. You can get one of those egg timers and you can put it under the screen so they can actually see it tick down, or you can set it on an alarm and they hear it. You can kind of empower kids by giving them the remote and getting them to press the button to turn it off, because then they feel like they have a little bit more control over it. You can also give them warnings and like, I'm going to turn this off when, you know, or we're only watching one show of Paw Patrol. So when, you know, you hear this certain song at the end of Paw Patrol, that means it's over. You can also kind of try to transition them to fun stuff outside of the screen. So when screens are over, then we're going outside. So you use these when then statements, or when screens are over, then we're playing Play-Doh, you know, like whatever might be something that they like. So you can try these different strategies. And as I said, they don't always work. And sometimes I wish I could film my own house so people could see that I can give these strategies, but they don't always pan out. But you know, I do think the best strategy in our house is actually getting my child to press the off button. There's something about that gives them control over turning it off. And it seems to be the easiest transition for us.
And what about for teenagers too? Sorry, I don't know if any of you can also speak to that for adolescents.
I was just going to add, and I think John mentioned it earlier, engaging teens or older children in kind of making the rules. And Sheri mentioned that as well. Like, how much time do you think is appropriate? When's the best time for you? Have you ever noticed, you know, when you use screens first thing in the morning, kind of makes you tired or it doesn't start your day off? If you can get them kind of to engage in some of the behaviors that are helpful or not helpful for them, then they are more likely to start kind of introducing those strategies themselves.
An important sort of frame of screen time for, as with a lot of things that kids like, is that they're rewards as opposed to things that are capped and taken away. So you sort of start at zero outside of school and extracurricular activities that need to be on screens. And then you work with your kids. So, okay, so I'd like to see you running around at least 30 minutes a day outside. How much screen time do you think that's worth? And so, and at a certain point, if the minutes are adding up, you're not going to be able to have, you know, 5 hours of screen time at night. But, you know, so when it's a framework of everything they're earning as opposed to what they're losing, kids, you know, as long as we're not talking about egregious misbehavior, you know, focusing on the positive and framing on what you're wanting from them can be really effective, and kids tend to buy in a lot more. They get excited about earning it. Again, just like Sheri, for every case this works with, there's a case that it doesn't work with. The other thing that I think is really important when I work with families and we're struggling with screen time and the kids, that they, it's important that families, as with any realm, this is not specific to screen time. This is, you know, with, you know, anything with kids, anything with humans, it's not even specific to kids. There's what in the field we call an extinction burst. Things get worse before they get better. When you create new rules, when you get in an elevator, if it's the elevator you get in every morning, you push the button and it closes the door and goes up to, let's say, the fourth floor where your office is. If one day you push that button and the doors don't close, what are you going to do? You're not going to get out of the elevator yet. You're going to push the button harder, and you're going to keep pushing it harder and keep pushing it harder until you give up on it. Kids' behavior is the same way. If you change the rules, all of a sudden that elevator door is not going to close when they do that. You change the rules. This is the new rules. It's going to get worse before it gets better. And the most important thing parents need to know is, behavior doesn't change from the creation of rules. Behavior changes from the carrying through of rules. Kids actually need to experience the consequences of not following what they're, you know, what you're getting them to do. So many parents, they give up right away because they say, oh, it didn't work. We created the rule and he ignored it. It's the carrying through, the follow through, the consistency. That's what changes behavior, not the creation of rules. So that's sort of a mindset also that I think is important with parents.
And I think that helps when you're a parent too. So like, what rules make sense for you? You know, like, I really like what John's saying, and I can flip it and saying, what rules make sense for me as a parent? Well, I get really tired of being asked from 4 to 7 p.m. repeatedly if I can have screens. So I make a rule as a parent that says, if all of these things are done, you know, your lunch is packed, you know, whatever, my kids do their laundry, so your laundry's done, whatever's done, you can have screens from 7 to 7:45, because that rule is also really predictable for me. And then I don't get asked a lot from 4 to 7. So I think, like, you've got to, you know, work with the individual needs of your child, but also work for what makes sense for you as a family in terms of rule creation. And again, you can make kids part of that rule. And our rule is that they get to do, you know, whatever they want from that 7 to 7:45 period. And then we do this wildcard rule where at any given point, any day of the week, they get to get 30 minutes after school, and they get to choose what day is their wildcard day, and they just get to have it. And then so it gives a bit of like spontaneity to their lives, but also some control into, you know, when's the best time to have that. So we have this consistent rule, and then we have this little wiggle room for like them to be able to make decisions about when's the right time for them to engage. So I think you can do some mix and matching and you know, really think about what makes the most sense for your kids and for you.
I think you have shared a little bit about how sort of providing a little bit of control to the child, maybe within some options that constrain how many sort of minutes they're going to be able to use or whatnot, can be helpful. In just looking at the time, I'm wondering if each of you could share just one piece of advice you'd give parents right now regarding screen time, sort of as a wrapping up moment. And Brae, maybe we could start with you.
You've probably been hearing, don't be hard on yourself. I think that still remains. Yes, we're in a pandemic and everyone is struggling, and you know, this tool is a great tool to keep your kids occupied. But much of what we talked about today, I think it does matter what they're doing. So really paying attention to the quality and trying to engage with them as much as you can.
Sort of a mantra that's getting me through this also is you just have to be good enough as a parent. You know, this is not the time you're gonna do your best work. You know, of course there's someone down the street that seems like they're thriving. They've got their own stuff going on. We're treating them in our clinic and they've got their own stuff going on. So, you know, you just have to be good enough. And just remember that, have some compassion for yourself and for your kid. This is a very difficult time. It feels so mundane sometimes, you know, for those who have not had immediate loss, it can feel so mundane, but you can really forget how messed up this time is and how our kids are being forced to put up with something that we were never forced to do. So really just some flexibility and compassion, and know that being good enough is actually gonna get most kids to do just what they need to do and get out of this great.
Yeah, well, that's a hard, tough act to follow. So I guess my last point would more be, you know, just thinking about what did you love about screens growing up? And what I can say I loved about screens is like watching a show together as a family, racing to the kitchen to get my drink and my popcorn at the commercial and getting back and then watching that, you know, finishing watching that show. I think it was Knight Rider, which dates me. But I think the part about screens that I love and that I hope families can think about is that it does have the potential for connection. So for me, it was about connection with my family members, but we can still make screens about connection. So right now there's a lot of push towards isolation around screens because we have these solitary tablets. So if we can push the tablets away, but actually make screens about connection, whether that's a family movie night, whether that's FaceTiming family relatives, whether if you have young kids and they have maybe cousins or friends, get them to log on together, FaceTime, and play whatever game they want to play that's cooperative, where they have to meet in there and they have to engage in some way. That's a point of connection. So these screens don't actually have to rule us. We can actually be in control of making it a connection point and making it meaningful. And I think that it's empowering to think that we have some of that control back. So as much as possible, make the screen time as meaningful as possible.
Thank you so much for leaving us on sort of a hopeful note here too. And thank you all for this amazing discussion. I'm gonna turn it over to Amanda now to sort of wrap us up for the evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Natalie, for go ahead.
Real quick, what do you wanna say? Real quick before, because John mentioned good enough parenting, and I just wanted to say very quickly, you were probably gonna do this, but that we did a whole webinar on good enough pandemic parenting, and that recording is on our website. So I would encourage you to check that out. But I also wanted to say that there's several great pieces that all of the guest panelists tonight have written, stuff that we didn't even get to talk about, like teens and sexting and, you know, how to keep your kids safe online. And John has some great stuff on how you can watch smartly in terms of media coverage. And so I have all of those links and we'll put them on our resources page that goes with this recording when we post it. So, but I think we're gonna have to do like round two at some point because we have so many unanswered questions still, but this is amazing. Thank you. And Amanda, take it over.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Lindsay. And thanks again to Natalie for moderating a great conversation. We're definitely going to need round two. And related to that, there have been so many wonderful questions that came in both tonight and before. So we will also be doing our best in the coming weeks, not only to post a lot of the resources that Lindsay mentioned that come from our wonderful panelists, but also just we're going to be writing some new blogs and posting other resources and such that will also speak to some of the questions that you answered. So stay tuned. We'll continue to try to tackle some of these topics and issues that you've raised. And please do check out the Good Enough Parenting webinar. There's also a couple of blogs we've written around these exact topics. I'm so glad that was shared and that all of our panelists have shared those reminders to just have some grace for yourself. So I really want to thank all of our panelists, Dr. John Comer, Dr. Sheri Madigan, and Dr. Brae Ann McArthur. We really appreciate you joining us. We know what a busy time this is and know that you are all pandemic parenting as well, your kids at home. So we appreciate you staying up past their bedtimes or your bedtimes to join us tonight. We're really, really grateful. Please let us know what you thought. There's a feedback link that Victoria has posted in the chat. That's really helpful to us. We take that feedback very much to heart. And please also let us know what other topics you'd like us to be tackling in early 2021. We invite you to please join us for our next pandemic parenting webinar, the last one for 2020, believe it or not, which will be on Thursday, December 19th. And many of you are new to our pandemic parenting community. So we're going to really be hitting on some of the highlights of the things we've talked about over the last 5 months or so. Lindsay and I will take you down a little bit of a stroll or a sprint down memory lane, but just invite you to come join us. And we're going to be kind of reflecting on how far we've all come in the last year and what we've survived and endured since the pandemic began. Please continue to share these resources with others and feel free to reach out anytime if you or your organization might like to partner with us in some way. And you can check out all of the resources and previous webinars on our website, which Victoria has posted in the chat. So we hope to see you again soon and just Thursday, very soon. And in the meantime, enjoy your holidays and please stay safe. And thank you again, everybody, for joining us.